Hey guys, welcome back to Home Built. And in this episode, we are getting right towards the pointy end of getting Harry back on the road. All right, those of you watching recently will have seen that we are almost there. And in the time off in the last couple of weeks, the engineers have actually been out and we've done all the brake testing on the Harry and it's passed. The engineers are happy with everything. They're just writing a report at the moment, waiting for that. Once the report comes in, we can actually register the car, which is amazing. The brake test was actually quite intense. I didn't film any of it because it was quite sort of rushed in the end. So basically they take it out on a closed track and they need to put a sensor on the pedal itself that you have to press onto. It's actually quite a big lump. It sort of makes it sort of a bit more difficult to press the pedal, but that tests how much foot pressure it takes to engage the brakes. Obviously, because mine are boosted, non-boosted brakes, it takes a bit more pressure than a boosted setup. But basically, they go through from 40 to zero and do a couple of those tests just to see how the brakes go and test what sort of pressure it takes to engage the brakes, and then speed up to 80 kilometers an hour to zero and do that a couple of times. So that's, you know, a higher speed and threshold braking to bring it up to a stop. And then they start going through a stress test really to get the brakes to fade on a really long stretch of track. They basically got me to go 80 to 40, 80 to 40, 80 hard brake to 40 and do that. We ended up running out of track at about 9 times. The brakes weren't fading. They were getting warm. You could tell they were getting warm, but they weren't fading, but that was just constant. And then straight around to an 80 to zero again, just to see how much the brakes have faded, how much longer it takes to stop, how much more pressure it takes. And sort of go through the hardest one, the one that was the car was having the most difficulty with, is because the brakes are actually too good. The sensor needed a certain amount of pedal pressure to engage the sensor, but they wanted a really slow braking, as in if you're coming up to a roundabout or something, and they wanted a nice gradual brake from 40 to zero. The trouble was that for me to put enough pressure on the pedal for the sensor to read my foot pressure, I was slowing down faster than what they want. So it takes little pressure to slow up nicely. The brakes feel great. The brakes feel really good. I'm quite happy with them. And interestingly, at the end, they do another 0 to 40 test to calibrate to see how the brakes have been after all of this brake testing, which was probably about a half an hour of solid brake testing. So there was a lot of, the brakes were definitely quite warm. And it's interesting that these pads that I've got in here performed really well. Basically, on the initial test, I think they registered 540 newton meters of force or something on my pedal to get it to stop to 540. It stopped in about the same distance at the end, but only took 350 newton meters or something. So it took a lot less pressure on the pedal at the end than it did at the start, which tells me that these pads like to get warm before they work at their optimum, but they still worked fine when they were cold. So I'm quite happy with them. They didn't fade, they did good. Anyway, enough blathering. I've actually finally got to the stage where I've got a bit of a job list, and we'll take you over and have a look at that now. All right, I've finally got to the stage where I've made a punch list of jobs to get done on Harry. This is not an exhaustive list, but this is just enough to get me going for the time being. So I'm going to start working through all of these and see what we can get done. First thing I'm going to tackle though is the gas struts, because Pete and Louis got them for me last week. Thank you guys if you saw that in the mail time episode. So I'm going to see how I go getting them to work on this car. Okay, so I only had one strut on this car when I got it, which was old and didn't hold the bonnet up, but that's this one here. I installed a new one on that side, and I'll show you now why I haven't installed the struts on the front. When I close the bonnet, on the weak side, besides this really nasty chip that I made in the paint, yes, there are lots of nasty chips in the paint because this has been kicking around the garage for a few years, and I am a pig working on these cars, so that's got to be repaired. There's a few repairs that I've got to do. But this corner is up slightly, but it's not too bad. Over the other side, that's a different situation. That is up far too much. It's just ridiculous. And that is why I can't have a gas strut on the bonnet. So at least for now, I'm going to take the gas struts out of the front, leave it without, and we will move on to something else. So the last couple of weeks off camera, I've actually been going through and working on the cold start issues. Since I placed that sensor the other week, it has made a world of difference to how this car starts and runs and keeps running. It is, we're really getting on top of it. It kept dropping out before and it was just not very nice to start and run. Now it does seem to start much better, cold. Still not perfect, but getting really, really close. So I'm going to do another cold start now, another log, and I've been sending it away to Adam at Link ECU in New Zealand. He has been fantastic going through and just giving me suggestions of tweaks. He's looking at the logs, and there's so many fine detail parts of the ECU that I don't fully understand. I haven't sat down and studied all of the different minor calibrations and what each setting does, that it's just so much easier being able to just send it to Adam. It just says, yeah, try this. I try it and it's getting better and better every time. So, all right, cold start again. As you can see, that's running so much better. It'll start now with zero throttle input, but when I first started it, it was sort of struggling to idle a little bit. The second time I started it, with a blip of the throttle, then it just sat nice and it was good. Sometimes I do, when I give a little blip of the throttle, it still seems to hang up at a higher idle for a while. So there's a few little bits and pieces that need tweaking. But either way, I wanted to start it up so that I can move it out now, give it a little bit of a wash and a clean, so then I can move forward on the next thing I'm going to tackle. So the next thing I'm going to have a look at is, obviously this wheel arch was rubbing a lot when I was on the dyno. I've actually swapped over and put the front wheel spacers onto the rear so for the testing the other day, so that the wheels were sitting inwards and they weren't going to rub on the lip. But this lip has actually bubbled and been damaged. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go over and I'm going to sand this back and try and touch it all up. So it's not gonna be perfect, but it's right on the lip. There's a chip out of it here. You can see in camera there, I'm sure. So sand it back now and see if I can get it looking a bit better than it does now. All right, so what I've been going through and doing is I masked up the area that I wanted to repair. I sanded it all back with 800 just to get rid of all the chips and the nastiness. Now I've laid a thin layer of bog over the top just to fill in the paint dips from where the edges are from the chips. I'm going to sand that back now lightly. I'm going to mask it up so that I keep the repair area as small as possible. And then we'll have to start thinking about what I'm going to do about painting. All right, so you can see here I've masked this up. I've used some 2-inch tape around the top edge, and I lay it so that it's still got a big overhang, and that's good to catch all the overspray. Now I'm going to be using the airbrush. I've mixed up some primer that I'm going to just put in the airbrush now and just dust the primer over just the smaller section, and that should be plenty for what I'm doing. So let's a quick prep cell, primer, and then get some paint on there. So I've gone through and laid a thin airbrush line of primer over the that little strip, and I've just knocked the edge of it off with just really lightly with the 800. I'm gonna go through now and do my soft edge masking, which is where I basically fold the tape on my leg over itself and make a soft edge. The tape is basically in thirds. It's sort of 1/3 that's sticky and 2/3 that are folded over on top of itself. And when I stick that down, it'll let some of the overspray sort of feather underneath this, and that's what gives you a nice softer edge rather than having that hard sharp mast edge. All right, soft masking is done, so it's time to go through and start blending in the orange. So all of this here, particularly being on an edge, has finished really well. Basically, you can't really see it anymore, at least not in this light. There is a little bit of a haze difference. It's not a perfect fix, but it does the job in this situation, and I'm happy with it. And you may be wondering why I went to all this trouble to do the paint touch-ups now, but there is Methodine Madness, and it'll all make sense next week. So you'll have to hang on for them. But for the time being, that is it for this week. As always, make sure if you need to get your Porsche parts, make sure you compare prices at PorscheParts.com first. And all the rest of the stuff, like, subscribe, all that garbage. All right, see you next time, guys.